Morning, respected panelists and viewers. I am Tripti from Team CREDAI MCHI with my co-host Charmi. Welcome to the 17th episode of CREDAI MCHI webinar, Key to Lockdown. And the key to lockdown is staying connected. I also take this opportunity to express our gratitude towards everyone working at the front line and helping us stay safe. That is our doctors, police force, Swachhata workers, people providing us with continuous supply of food and milk, and our volunteers, government officers, and everyone risking their lives for us. I would request Binita to please take over the screen.
Thanks so much, Tripti. Good evening to everyone, and welcome to the MCHI webinar. I think each session that we've been having, and I'm very thankful to all the panelists who've kept joining us, has been a learning space for all of us, and I'm happy that we always have everyone's support and everyone keeps joining in time on each of the webinars. I think we have a very interesting conversation that we're going to have today, and we've got very, very, I would say a very distinctive and a very learned panel with us, starting with Mr. Irfan Kazi.
That was a direct reference to Nippon, so you can start with it.
I like that the camaraderie that everyone's having on this. So I'll just, with Mr. Kazi's permission, go ahead and start off by introducing him. So Mr. Kazi is, like everyone knows, he's a chief investment officer of the Swami Fund. The Swami Fund was something that the government of India had recently brought out to help the real estate sector come out of a stress situation by providing last mile funding. And he's joined the investment manager in 2018. He has 23 years of international work experience in various facets of alternate investments, such as sourcing, analyzing, recommending proposals for real estate and private equity investments. At the start of his career in financial services, Mr. Irfan was actively involved in managing IPOs and market making on the OTC exchange of India at companies such as Times Guarantee and Lloyds Finance. After that, he spent 7 years in Dana Investments Company, where his mandate was investments and management of funds and alternative assets. Later, during the last 13 years, he's been active primarily in real estate, private equity investments in asset management companies as ICICI Venture, Everstone, AIG Global Real Estate India, and L&T Infra Investment Partners. At ICICI Ventures, as Associate Director Investments, he was responsible for real estate investments in parts of Southern India. At Everstone, as Senior Vice President and Head of Investments, he played a key investment role in raising two international funds aggregating USD 450 million for investments in the hospitality and warehousing sector. At L&T Infra, as principal, he helped raise and manage INR 594 crores domestic infrastructure fund AIF, and later ideated and created a high yield real estate investment portfolio. Irfan has a bachelor's degree in electronic engineering and a master's in management studies from Jamnalal Bajaj Institute of Management Studies, and is a Indian charter holder from ICFAI Hyderabad and has been awarded the CFA charter by the CFA Institute USA. Apart from that, we also have Mr. Nipun Sahni, who is partner Apollo Global. Mr. Nipun Sahni joined Apollo in 2015 as partner and is responsible for the real estate investment business in India. He is part of the Asia Real Estate Leadership Team that is responsible for investing across Asia. Prior to that, from time 2011 to 2014, Mr. Sahni was the founder of Rezone Investment Advisors, a boutique investment advisory firm focused on Indian real estate. From 2006 to 2010, Nipun was a partner and managing director at Merrill Lynch and a member of the investment team in Asia. Prior to that, Mr. Sahni was a managing director at GE Capital India and held multiple roles during this period, including real estate investment and structural finance. Mr. Nipun is nominated as the chairperson of the Indian Real Estate Group at IVCA by the industry peers and is a member of the core committee that represents the private equity investment community in the country. And I think the best person who will be moderating this session, which is primarily on how to bridge the gap towards last mile funding in real estate in India is Mr. Shovit Agarwal, and I'm sure he's feeling extremely in the spot right now for this moderation. And I think what I can say for Shovit very confidently is he's a friend, philosopher, and guide. He comes off as MD and CEO of Anurag Capital Markets, but I think heart and heart, Shovit is the person to go to when everyone has a challenge and when everyone wants their way out in life. So I don't think Shovit wants me to read his entire profile. So I'll refrain from that, and I'll hand over the session to Shovit. It's all yours, and the floor is open to have a nice afternoon with all our distinguished panelists.
Thank you, Binita. You've made my day. I'm feeling happy and chirpy in these times. So good evening, everyone, to all the listeners. I think there are about 400 odd people. First of all, it's my privilege to have Nipun and Irfan both. It's a very, very special day. I think I was told this is the 17th session. So there's lots that's been discussed on the economy and the impact of economy on real estate. So we'll keep this session more focused around financing and what's the impact on financing and how we will solve it. Binita just introduced. So we have two very distinct sort of people on the panel. One, Nipun sort of was with Merrill, GE Merrill, and now Apollo. Manages a large pool of international capital and has a very different perspective from Irfan, who's managing the sovereign fund, the first sovereign fund, and it's a very specific mandate to do what it has to do. Let me just start with Irfan. I think he's the man on the spotlight today. Irfan, can I just start with two things? One, if you could sort of decode Swami, what is it? Is it that people have to pray to you to get the money, or does it mean anything else? And second, what was the genesis of this fund? Why did government do this and not anything else? There were like 500 things that could have happened. So what was the whole purpose of setting up Swami in the first place? I think our listeners would love to know. All of these are largely, in my view, developers from different parts of Maharashtra or even national. Is it, Binita, is it national?
This is largely Maharashtra, MMR.
Largely MMR. So there'll be people from all over the place trying to understand what Swami can do. Why was it created and what can it do?
Thanks, Shovit. And thank you, Crida MCHI, for giving me this opportunity. Mujhe is izzat ke layak samjha aap logon ne. So thank you so much for that. Very clearly, the fund was set up to complete stalled projects. That's nothing new that I'm saying. We had done a market study. The industry has been plagued with this problem for some time now. And it's only after after we did a market study, we could quantify the numbers that the extent of the problem played out, and therefore the need for a solution was required, right? The solution that was, and therefore since the government is providing a solution or suggesting a solution, it was also felt that it has to be a comprehensive solution. It has come after some time, and therefore it can't be a piecemeal measure. It can't be one step in a solution. And therefore, it needs to be a comprehensive solution. And that led to the the idea of a last mile fund, a fund that will come in, fund the or walk the talk that it is there to complete the project, right? In terms of the need, there are very, very public numbers now. I run the most public private equity fund ever. Which is there are 4.5 lakh incomplete units, 1509 projects. Most of these units are stalled in places like NCR and MMR. So about 40% are in NCR, about 20% or so are in MMR. But the top 8 cities together account for about 80-85%. And therefore, the problem is both local large in scale and yet strangely localized. So that's one. The effort from the government was not, while we are talking to developers, understand this bit that the fund is stepping in to provide relief to home buyers. It is not stepping in to refinance debt, and therefore it cannot refinance debt. It is not stepping in to provide provide a kitty to the developers or provide funding to the developers. It is very clearly stepping in to complete the project, and that's the whole mandate.
And this funding is for only mid-income and affordable housing, and that's the whole genesis. So yeah. You will not so much to do luxury.
So it's 4 or 5 points very quickly. One, it's for affordable and mid-income housing. We've defined that on the basis of size as well as price. The emphasis while determining both the size and price criteria was to ensure that a maximum number of projects meet that criteria. So we did a back study and we saw about 90% of the total stalled projects meet the criteria. So as long as the price is less than 2 crore, 1.5 crore and 1 crore, depending on the geography where you are in, and the size is less than 200 square meters, and 200 square meters is about 100 square meters more than most of the houses I have stayed in, right? As long as it meets that criteria, it qualifies as affordable and mid-income. So that's one. The second criteria, and I'm talking fast because I just want to quickly get over with the criteria, which is the project should be 30% complete, the project should be RERA registered, and the funding is important. The funding should be last mile funding, and the funding is for projects which are cash flow positive or net worth positive. So for the first time ever, we've used this terminology of net worth, which finance guys understand as applicable to a company. We've used it as applicable to a project. So as long as the cost to complete the project is less than the inflows that are available, the project is net worth positive. And with those kind of criteria, if a project meets all those criteria, we can fund it.
Absolutely, Irfan. This was a good sort of summary. Five things that sort of qualifies. So it's a very, in my view, it's a very defined mandate by the government to say mid to affordable housing, size of the project, value of the project, completion milestone, and of course, customers should be there, right? So and RERA registered, right? Yeah. One quick thing, Irfan, before I move to Nippon, is have you actually started to deploy? And what's going on that side? Because it was announced only in October, if I remember right, mid 7th October, I thought. And so have you started to deploy?
So it was announced on 7th of November.
November.
We did the first closing on 6th of December. And in the 4 months or so that have elapsed since then, we have taken 40 deals through the investment committee process. 6 deals have got final approval. 31 deals have got initial approval and are in various stages of the due diligence process as we speak. And that's that. In terms of deployment is subject to, Shobhit, as you understand, we will give final approval. And in terms of our final approval, we'll say that there are maybe 2-3 condition precedents that have to be met before the funding actually starts, right? So, and achieving those CPs is beyond our control. It's something that the developer needs to do. So I can look at the bit of homework that I have finished and report back to people like you that we have given final approval to 6 projects.
Thank you, Irfan. I think that's a very, very good summary of what Swami Fund does. Nippon, I'll come to you. I think you've been sort of investing in Indian real estate for over 15 years, pre-GFC, post-GFC, pre-ILFS, post-ILFS, now pre-COVID. I'm not sure whether you've done anything post-COVID. So what's your take on the sentiments of foreign investors? Are you going to continue to deploy, and how has it changed for you? Is anything changed, first of all? I mean, you've been so disciplined about investing. You've done some really good deals, right from the big ones to small ones. You've invested in hotels. You've invested in retail. Swami Fund's mandate is very residential. So in that sense, I'm quite happy to have you on the panel saying it's very rounded. What's happening on the foreign fund side?
So thanks for having me on this. It's good to know that there have been 17 other sessions. So I think a lot has already been talked about. So for the audience, I don't know what new can we say after so many panelists in the past have really already spoken, including people like Mr. Parekh. But let me start by saying, for one, I was feeling very disappointed in 2019 to be part of the real estate sector, and we were getting hammered from everywhere. There was demonetization, there was RERA, GST, ILFS, every crisis was impacting the sector. And, now you feel better that all sectors are with us. There is no sector which is now left out of this crisis. Real estate and telecom were probably in a deep shit last year. But I think now, suddenly, you have company. But on a more serious note, I think the sector has been trying to reach out to regulators as well as government through various other platforms, including CREDAI, NAREDCO. Am I audible, Shobhit?
Yes, yeah, you're audible.
Okay. So through various real estate and non-real estate platforms, basically seeking solutions. And I think it's now at that moment, and crescendo is coming up, where I think it's, which was getting kind of pushed back by regulators and others. But you can increasingly see that with all other sectors impacted and everything kind of coming under this COVID umbrella, finally, the time you can't kick the can down the road any further. Solutions have to be found. Everybody's back is to the wall, including probably the government. And I can see a lot more sense of urgency to rather just debate the problem of whether there is a problem or is there not a problem. Half the time, the debate was just on that topic, where the sector said we have a problem and the regulators and others probably felt, no, there's no problem. You guys can figure it out. But I think now everybody is trying to collectively figure out a solution. There is more dialogue, trying to find some middle ground. The one-time restructuring solution which has come is definitely helpful. And that was a big solution that came for the real estate, I guess, sector in terms of, maybe the right word is not restructuring, but I think there was commercial real estate was allowed some concessions by the bank and NBFC. It's been extended to NBFCs, I believe, as of last week. The Swami Fund was another pool of capital which was creating liquidity to solve last mile financing issues. And I'm sure there are a few steps which are underway, even like literally as we speak, in the next few weeks. I'm part of some of those discussions. And I think there should be more coming to just alleviate the concerns on the sector. But frankly, I think what you can't resolve is the collapse in demand. The demand collapse because of COVID and the impact that will have is a whole new dimension which has got added. I think a lot of things are really happening on the supply side, supply of money. I think that hopefully can ease out if the government can increase the limits on whatever are the existing limits. I think that will be a big relief for liquidity to the sector. If the customers hopefully keep paying, once this moratorium is over, that will be a huge relief if customers can. So this is a very, very complex problem. I don't think any of us, including myself, is an expert who can really say how this will all play out. I think it's just perspective. But what you can do is you have to really manage two things on an immediate basis. You have to manage, whether it's real estate or any other business, you have to manage your liquidity and you have to manage your leverage. So if you're kind of managing these two things, then you are basically, at least you have a chance to fight back. And I think everybody needs to contribute to the solution between government, regulators, PSU banks, NBFCs, foreign funds, developers. I think it's time that the industry tries to work together like never before to try and come up with as many solutions as possible, because if not now, when? And when do you stand up to be counted?
Nipun, I'm going to pick up one of those threads. You said everything else is quite kind of predictable except sales. Right, and when the sales are going to come back, and you know, somebody has to future gaze, because that is the revenue stream, right? Which we are all underwriting to. So how would you look at it now? If there was a last mile financing proposal, what would be your top three or four things that you'd look at before sort of saying yes or no, right? So
Shobhit, I'll flip the role. I'll become the moderator. And we will ask you the question, because you are Mr. Anorak.
Okay.
And nobody knows more about residential real estate sales in Maharashtra than Anorak. You know, no developer, no government. So maybe we should flip the question. I think it's tough. You know, you take a shot. I'll give you my perspective, but you have a lot of data points internally. It's still early days in the crisis, so it's going to be tough to predict. You are in the first month maybe of a lockdown, but I think how the coming months pan out is a lot of speculation, but why don't you take a shot at it, and I'll add.
And Shobhit, if I can just come to your rescue for just a second, I know he's put you on the hot seat, but just responding to what Nipun mentioned, right? It will take some time, demand will languish, sales will take some time to come back. And therefore, you know, how do you keep yourself constructively employed, right? By progressing with construction. So I think this is the time when funds like us that have this very, very specific mandate will use this time constructively. And I'm playing with words, obviously, or trying to, that we will proceed with construction. And then we will wait for demand and sales to catch up.
So you are saying in your underwriting, Irfan, if I just simply put it for the audience who's listening, you are saying you are willing to wait out on sales. There's no pressure on sales. And that while you are underwriting the project, you're assuming no future sales or no collection from sold inventory to ensure that you have enough money for closure or up to the closure of the project. Is that right?
So the strange thing is when we were doing that in all our proposals, you know, everybody thought that, you know, you are being unnecessarily pessimistic, and probably the nature of the person, the people in the team and so on. We were assuming very, 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 very low reliance on receivables as well as sales. We were assuming that sales will take, you know, at least a year or more to catch up, right? And therefore, the funding we provide will not be reliant on cash inflows from any other source. And therefore, we were looking at, you know, funding 90-95% of the cost to complete, when the ask to us very strangely was, you know, to provide for that catalyst 20-25% of capital. Understood. And somehow, you know, it seems like that might be the only way going ahead.
So you are saying it's very simply getting equated more to like an office project where you don't depend, or you don't even forecast a sale or revenue when the project is under construction. You assume that all the revenue is back-ended, and therefore whatever money is required, please assume that the bank or the fund like you will provide, and that's the only way to go forward. Is that right?
So Shobhit, that is the starting point. That is, you know, what, or rather that is the target we try to achieve. But then we have to step back a bit, you know, make certain alliances, assume for certain receivables, assume for certain sales, because otherwise the project might not be able to take the interest cost of that funding.
Okay.
Right. So the idea is to do it. The idea is not to to prove that it can't be done. And therefore, we'll have to make investment calls. And that's where, you know, our role comes in. Even with sharply defined criteria, make investment calls to try and pick up the deals that you can do.
I have three more questions that are pertinent, Irfan, more for you. Saying when you say construction, close of construction, do you assume just CC, or do you assume the cost right up to formation of society? Because most of us, when we are forecasting, we are saying completion is defined as the day we get OC, and not really, that may not be the end point of the project.
So we are not constraining ourselves to an OC milestone. We are saying that, you know, whatever needs to be completed before the home buyer can move in.
So everything is included. That includes everything.
Yeah.
And two questions I'm getting already on the chat group. One is two challenges they're saying. Can you just sort of elaborate? Do you get NOC from existing lenders? Number one. And number two, what happens to cancellations, requests that come in because the projects have been stuck? Can we use the money that we draw from SWAMI Fund for paying out to aggrieved customers?
So our idea, to answer the last question first, our idea is to step in and complete construction of the project. It is not to step in and provide refund to every customer who wants it, right? The idea should be that the vast majority of the home buyers get the home that they were planning to buy. So that is the, so while we provide for certain RERA liabilities, we cannot completely provide for cases where, you know, there is a 100% cancellation or there is a large amount of cancellation. So that is a liability that we, that's a, almost an open liability that we get in with. Everything else is, we are well covered in terms of providing for the capital to complete the construction. Sorry, what is the first question?
What happens to existing lenders? Because when you're talking about last mile, typically you would have projects that are stuck for shortfall of money, but there'll be existing lenders on it.
Yeah.
So what do you get NOC from them?
So we are doing two things, right? One, we are saying that last mile funding necessarily has to be senior funding. We are not rewriting the book here. That is the most obvious ask from any last mile funder, and internationally as well. So there is nothing new here. The last mile funding funder requires senior charge. Requiring senior charge would mean that some of the existing lenders seed charge. So they have two options. One, to complete the project without our funding, don't seed charge, complete the project without our funding. And, you know, I'm happy to say that we have been the catalyst in some projects, that we've completed homes without providing a single rupee of capital.
Because you issued term sheets.
Because we said we are willing to do the funding, and therefore the bank said, you know, let us do it, right? Rather than seeding charge. So that's good.
That's not a bad outcome. That's a very good outcome.
So if we measure outcome like we do on number of homes completed for every rupee of capital deployed, right? Here the returns are infinite. So that's one. Two, there are a lot of banks, there are a lot of NBFCs that have begun the process of seeding charge, that have seeded charge. So we've got all the six deals that we've completed, we have the underlying lender that has seeded charge. So where they see a reality that the existing institution isn't going to do the incremental financing, and you would like the status quo to be, or you would like the future to be different from the current status quo, you would want someone to come in and complete the funding, banks and other financial institutions have seeded charge.
So you're saying there is a willingness that's starting to build up. In the beginning, there was resistance, but now people are understanding it. And most current lenders are willing to seed charge. They're willing to top up fund, or they're willing to do the top up funding.
We are seeing incremental movement in that direction.
We are seeing incremental. So obviously there was resistance, but it's changing.
Yes.
Quickly moving, I know while this question answers, there's a chat box that's sort of building up. Nipun, I'm just coming to you. I think what I heard Irfan say is one of the genesis of the fund was some 450,000 units stuck in 1,600 projects. I'm assuming this study was done pre-COVID, pre-March. My sense is that this number is incrementally going to be increasing. Whenever the results are out for March quarter, which means June quarter at the moment, it's looking like banks will give out their results. And my sense is that there will be further NPAs and further projects like this. I don't think there's one fund, which is Swami, which is enough to take care of all these 1600. Plus there's retail, plus there is office, and so many places. I know he said RERA compliant. There are states do not have RERA, right? How do you see this opportunity? And Nipun, how will you take advantage of it? Will you go more towards resi? Will you go more towards offices? And of course, the big section that's getting left out is mid to luxury income housing, right? Because the fund doesn't allow you to do, I mean, they're talking about 2 crores. So it's really all of South Bombay, central parts of any city is going to be missed out on this. So how do you take advantage of this situation?
See, there's no formula, Shobhit, on this. There is each solution, each problem is going to be different. Each developer would have challenges at an industry level. Yes, there's a fundamentally a sales issue. If you keep using conventional tools of, you know, using the same type of funding from an NBFC or a bank, you have to put all creative solutions on the table. And I think what we and most foreign investors try and do at least is solution capital. Solution capital has no formula. We have no formula. We have no that we have to be first in, last out, last in, first out. I think the question is, number one, in any project, the project game secondary. According to me, the most important thing is, who are you doing business with? Who's the developer? What is the credibility of the developer? What has been their track record for the last whatever time frame, 5, 10, 15 years? What you know, have they been able to deliver in the past, and this is a small crisis which has come now? How does that track record play out? And that is fundamental to coming out of this crisis. Ultimately, it's the customer who has to buy the units which are unsold. We can build these units, we can complete these, but ultimately, you know, that demand side of the equation is going to be very critical. And where will demand go? Especially in a situation like this, there are existing set of buyers who might be stuck in projects and they have committed to that. Hopefully they don't cancel. But if you're looking for incremental buyers, I think two things are clearly, they were already in play pre-COVID. I think it'll happen now. Just give me. So I think the key is that the trend of buyers gravitating to higher quality developers in each city was already underway. The trend of buyers gravitating to projects which are complete or nearing completion was already underway. That will only accelerate as and when the customer comes back. Developers with the track record and projects which are nearing completion, you are going to see maximum traction, I think, come in that product. And if that is the case, I think for investors like ourselves, I think our approach is solution capital. Can you do it across a few projects? Do you have to take out lenders? Because in a lot of cases, you know, every lender might want to take out some money off the table. But can the project cash flows really support all this? And I think that's how you, it's like a suit, right? You can go and buy it off the shelf if you are a standard size, but that doesn't happen, right? More often than not, you get it custom tailored to what you want. And that is the kind of capital that players like ourselves and players who are flexible capital, because we don't have regulatory constraints of banks and NBFCs. You have to sit and stitch the suit.
Excellent. That sort of comes brings me to a point where I know Swami can't do this, but can you provide capital or in situation like this where, you know, people are talking about consolidation? Right, a lot of projects may change hands during this time and may require some kind of acquisition funding, right? Maybe small amounts, not that you want to buy land which is completely greenfield, but it requires that kickstart and mobilization money. Will you provide, will you look at situations like that? with, of course, good grade developers. I'm assuming that this is sort of, it's like Pied Piper music. It's moving towards better developers, well governed, well respected, who manage their cash flows well, but require external help because they don't have enough equity.
Yeah, I think it'll happen. It's natural. It was already underway. I think it'll all accelerate. It was already happening. Transactions where developers were stretched were selling out to bigger, better players. And doesn't need to be bigger necessarily, but even if smaller players were solvent and maybe had the credibility. But yes, more often than not, we are only a financial investor, not a strategic investor, and don't have any development expertise. So if developers are trying to acquire projects, whether it's office, whether it's residential, or even could be retail in today's environment, because there will be stress in those assets too. If those kind of projects, and nothing of this can be short term. You don't need 6 month, 12 month solution of capital. You need 3 to 5 year solution capital. And I think that will definitely accelerate after this. M&A in this sector would be in my view, at a pace which this sector has not seen, as long as the developers community within themselves are willing to step into other projects. There has been an aversion because everybody has their own issues in their own projects. Nobody really wants to. I haven't seen too many developers stepping in to say, if some other developer project has a problem, let me go in and solve it. We saw a few of them. We saw a few of them were coming in as DM or, you know, JDs, etc. But I think that is one of the solutions, because you don't need only just financial capital to resolve projects. You also need execution capability and credibility. You know, the biggest thing is the credibility factor with the customer and the entire ecosystem. So players who have that, once, if they have the confidence, then I think it's not going to happen in a rush. If they have the confidence to come in, they do have their partners as capital. We have partners in almost every city. And if those development partners find projects exciting, there'll be capital to back them. And I can tell you that there is a lot of liquidity available globally, and there will be more available, not less. The question is, how much of that is India ready to take? And does the government ease up the guidelines? Because right now, I think there are still certain restrictions where you cannot do certain type of transactions. But that will be very important. And one more important thing for other investors, which Swami Fund already has, is that under the bankruptcy law, the lender who provides last mile financing, even in a bankruptcy situation, should be treated as the senior most lender. As per the current bankruptcy norm, if it's silent, and what it implies is, in the absence of an intercreditor or clarification on the law, you can become pari passu. You might think you've done senior secured financing, but the legal view is that no, that if a project or a company goes into bankruptcy, then that will again become pari passu with the senior lender. So the same benefit which has been extended to Swami needs to get extended to all investors looking at last mile financing and senior financing. But if it's solution capital resolving some other part of the capital structure like mezz or equity, I think that will work.
Nipun, you bring out a very important point. Thanks for the clarification. And I'm going to bring Irfan right in. Irfan, what is going to happen in case a project funded by Swami Fund goes into NCLT? Do you still get priority?
Yeah, absolutely. So,
and is this specific for Swami Fund, or is this general law?
It is an amendment to the IBC Act, and it's specific to the Swami Fund.
Okay.
So that is exactly what I'm saying, Shobhit, that you know, it is specific. And if it can, and if the government and the sector, it's not a small problem. It's not a 25,000 crore problem. It is a 2,50,000 crore problem. It's 10 times that problem, you know, over whatever time frame. So if that's the size and scale of the issue, why not let that benefit be available to all funds? Because ultimately, that is how a capital structure is supposed to work, where, you know, the senior most part of the capital structure gets paid out as per the intercreditor and the capital stack. So you're not allowing the capital stack to function. And because you're not allowing the capital stack to function, that's why you're not seeing more capital coming into the market.
No, you're absolutely right, Nipun. But I, my hope was that Swami will pave the way for last mile financing. I think they have already done, where at least the current senior lenders have started to recognize that there is the last mile financing people that are required. NOCs have started to come. And my guess is that IBC has to recognize and hopefully will recognize. And that's one request.
I think all IBC needs to do is very simply say we will respect the intercreditor. Whatever the senior lenders and the incoming capital agrees, respect that. If it is you make everything senior, you make everything senior. If it is you'll split it 80-20, you split it 80-20. You can have a formula. Respect the intercreditor. It's respected in every jurisdiction, whether it's the US, UK, Germany, other markets. All these countries respect the intercreditor agreement. And that's all that we need to do. And I think, you know, given the scale of capital needed, you need to come out with innovative things and amendments, because the traditional sources of capital will not suffice to solve the need for liquidity and the complexity that we find ourselves in.
Nipun, you know, like I said, this is a very closed group of developers, and the question, I can see the chat box sort of filling up, and one of the questions is, how should we think about funding rates, interest rates, processing fees, and how fast can transactions be done in this environment? I mean, would you be able to, you know, not you, as I don't want to say it as Apollo, but as a body, be able to write deals in the next 3-6 months? Are you going to pause for 3 months and then start? And is the I'd said it on one of the panels, saying, you know, dollar denominated money is looking at 15% dollar return, which is roughly 20-21% India rupee return. Is that sort of, would you agree with it? And would you, what's your view on this?
So I think India has a risk premium because of the currency. Historical depreciation on the currency is 4-5%. You just have to factor it in. Unfortunately, you know, the hedging costs are high. You've already seen a sharp depreciation happen in the last few weeks. Only $15 billion left India, 15 to 18 billion because of stock markets. And you've seen the currency slip a few percentage points. So markets are shallow. Foreign investors, most of them do take care of the currency issues. I think, again, there is no one pricing. There is no 14, 15, 18, 20. Who needs the money and for what? How do you structure the money? How much should be coupon? What is the equity upside, if any, left in the project? Yes, it's very. This is not the environment for equity transactions, not only in India, but worldwide. The volatility is too high and the bid-ask spreads are too wide between a seller and a buyer to realistically think that in the next couple of months, any equity, meaningful equity deals can get done, because there's just so much uncertainty that you really can't price it. And the sellers might not want to transact given it's like a distressed situation. So hence, you are kind of constructing a transaction based on no fixed coupons or some downside coupons with equity upsides. I think there will have to be creativity and solution around it. But yes, for the first dollars of capital will end up going to the more kind of credible guys, relatively bigger players who are if they are not able to access capital. And I think M&A is in the phase after that. However, if people recognize that it's time to just move on and get out of projects and be realistic around pricing, then there are it's already happening in developed markets. We ourselves are part of some transactions in countries which are maybe facing similar situation and lenders who are dealing with bankruptcy issues to buy assets, in which case, if those conversations are people are willing to have that, then there could be pools of capital, but not for every asset class. I don't think there's anything available for greenfield risk at this point in time. But if there is brownfield risk or completed assets, which are because even asset sales will play a role in generating liquidity. If you have to pay 21% interest for 5 years or 20-some percent interest, then is a developer better off just selling some other asset and generating liquidity through that route, maybe at a lower valuation than what it was, say, in January or February? Or do you go with a high-cost financing? That's a decision which each developer will take on their own. But I think more than the cost, it's the availability of capital which is more important. I think capital can get deployed at most costs. I think there are takers. The question is, are you able to access capital almost at and I think the cost is important, but I think that's the second part of the discussion.
Absolutely. Just moving back to Irfan, just on that point, when I spoke to Nipun on interest cost, what's the interest rates? Is it a prescriptive, or even in your fund, it is subjective, right? To say every deal will have a different interest rate.
So let me just start from the beginning. The Swami Fund is different, right?
Hmm.
It is more of an impact fund rather than a commercial private equity fund. And that's where the differential treatment or the justification for the differential treatment comes in. So we are senior, we are insisting on coming in as senior, but just look at what we are doing, right? Our emphasis is as much on the social impact that we are creating as the return that we are trying to generate for our investors. And there is a reason for generating the return, because we want to attract even more capital to create a greater social impact. Now, what we are saying is we are going to complete construction of projects. We are going to, so many of the projects that we are looking at are stalled for the last, let's say, 8 to 10 years. So we are saying we'll complete the construction of those stalled projects, and then we'll take a sales risk. We'll wait out for the next 4 to 5 years to try and get our capital back. We are also saying that we look at deals across the spectrum from 5 crores to 400 crores for a single project. We are saying that we look at geographies across India. So we look at tier 2, tier 3, and even smaller places. And as long as, you know, in our analysis, the project cash flows are positive, we will fund the project. It would be difficult to get a fund which will promise you, you know, at least a couple of those 3-4 things that I mentioned.
Absolutely. Most of the international capital is going to top 7 cities.
Then coming to the kind of return expectations we have. So we are now effectively saying that our funding is priced at anywhere between 14 to 15%. It is entirely back-ended, so that all inflows will be used for construction only. Right? I'm not being repetitive. It is that, you know, that is our objective. So all inflows from receivables and from incremental sales, which in any case we are assuming will happen after the project is completed. If at all they come in, they'll be used for completion of the project. So,
and does your completion include the premiums in case of Bombay and Maharashtra? There are lots of premiums to be paid to the government at different points of time.
So the way we look at it, you know, rather than being confronted with 100 questions that, you know, it's our architectural fees, architecture fees, construction payments, our marketing and brokerage charges, construction payments, and so on, we have chosen to define construction as all payments that are not related to repayment of financial liabilities.
So everything is payable.
Everything is included, right? It's a comprehensive definition, which becomes comprehensive by the fact that it defines by exclusion. Okay. So if it's not related to payment of financial liabilities in a project, it is considered as project-related expenditure, something that we could fund. Coming back to the cost of our funding, we are now saying that our funding will be at 15% IRR. that 15% will get reset to 14% if the project meets the business plan targets that were laid out at the start of the project in consultation with the developer. So it's entirely possible that our funding will be a 14% IRR funding in some cases. It will be, you know, we are going to use the standard rate across projects, though, you know, admittedly, the risk profile of projects is different, right? But we are using the same rate across projects. The funding could be at, will be at 15%, which will get a reset adjusted to 14%. When the project meets the business plan criteria, and we'll evaluate this on a quarterly basis. So in every quarter, we'll decide the rate applicable for the quarter going ahead. So that I think is the whole picture that that you should be considering when you look at, you know, should the project, should the fund have senior funding or not.
You know, since we are talking to people, since our listeners are mostly in MMR, two very specific questions that are coming in. Would you fund slum rehabilitation project, which is a very popular scheme in Bombay and Pune, SRAs, and you know, you see them starving for money. So that includes their rents, it includes rehab construction costs. Would you look at SRAs, number one? Is that possible? And number two, I don't know, there must be some people outside of Bombay who are saying, will HERA be also considered as RERA? Which is the specific question that's come in from somebody, I guess, who's doing projects in West Bengal.
So the quick answer to the second question is, the fund has a mandate to do RERA registered projects, okay, right? To answer your first question, one of the deals that has got final approval is a SRA project. So any SRA project will have a sale component. And as long as it has a sale component, we will be willing to fund the project.
But not the cost that is associated with rehab.
We will look, obviously, we are looking at the cost of rehab also. Okay. So when we consider project cost, the entire cost of rents, construction of the rehab portion, and anything else, you know, construction of, let's say, the nursery school, the temple, or whatever is required as part of the rehab agreement will be considered.
Well done, Irfan. I think this is a great, great thing for Maharashtra. And alluding to Nipun's sort of forecast, and which we also believe that, you know, projects will gravitate towards bigger developers, it is very difficult to do a JV-JD sort of deal because it involves stamp duties. Any movement of immovable property will include it. So people are doing DMs as a midway solution to this. Would the DM fee be allowed as part of project expense?
So, you know, the terminology that Nipun used, solution capital, right? So we'll try and find solutions for anything and everything. So yes, DM fees will be considered as part of project cost. Now, the only discussion that will happen on a deal-by-deal basis is, you know, to what extent will the DM fees be upfronted, and to what extent will they be junior to payouts to the fund?
So you're saying there will be some adjustments that you'll require, but very much possible.
So depending on how the numbers play out in every project, there will be some, shades to that color. But as a rule, we are already looking at projects which have a DM arrangement.
Super. So both, what I've sort of taken away from this, this conference or this webinar is you're saying capital is available in plenty, you know, both domestic and international, but you're saying Swami, of course, Nipun said, it's a pre-tailored suit mostly. Some adjustments you can make, but with foreign capital and Apollo, you can actually sit and figure out if the solution works. And if it works, then A, capital is available. B, the pricing will be decided based on the risk that's there. But naturally, it is going to be more expensive than Swami Fund, which is a government initiative. I'm going to leave some time because there's going to be loads of questions that are coming in. Vinita, you want to take some questions? We have about 15 minutes. I think there are loads and loads of questions that are pouring in. So we have to
thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much, guys. I think that's very informative, both Nipun and Mr. Irfan. Like, I think it's an eye-opener, because I think today, if you look from anyone's perspective, everyone is looking at last-mile funding, because once, you know, you get back to work, you really want to know how to fund your projects. So just a question out there. What is the mindset change that COVID is going to have on your last mile funding fund? And, you know, how are you guys looking at it in times to come? Because I think the biggest question everyone has is that, you know, once viability comes in, they need money to finish their projects. So they're all actually going to look at the Swami fund, as well as, you know, into people who are looking at last mile funding through the FDI route. So what is it that you guys will look at when the times come going forward? Mr. Irfan, you want to go first, and then we'll bring in Nipun to pick up?
So strangely, you know, unlike everybody else, there's not going to be a dramatic change in the way we look at projects. We were anyway considering a discount to the achievable price some kind of a weighted average price that was achieved in the last 1 or 2 years before the project came to us. That situation is, yeah. You know, what more needs to be done on that front. We were anyway assuming that there are going to be little or no sales till the project is completed. We were anyway assuming reliance to the extent of maybe 10% or 20% on receivables. But that's about it, right? Hmm. So there isn't, there is not going to be a significant difference in our underwriting in the post-COVID era. Strangely, but you know, if you are showing zero sales, you can't make it negative sales, right? To some extent, you could provide for some refunds and so on, but that's about it. So, I don't think much is going to change in terms of the way we would look at projects.
Just a quick question.
That's extremely reassuring.
Just a quick question.
Just quickly. Please, Shobhit. After you,
just one quick question, Irfan. Would you allow? Let's say Apollo, who's on this webinar, to co-invest with you. Would that be allowed? And Nipun, would you like to co-invest with Swami, because they're getting IBC protection, such a strict mandate, money's always not enough, right? So he's got 12,500 in right now. It can go up to 25,000, but if you are allowed to co-invest, maybe that's the solution to say, look, more money can come in, foreign capital can co-invest with Swami, and that's why they get a larger pie. They can invest in more projects. Over to both of you, Irfan and
We would welcome other funding sources to come in to act as maybe pseudo equity or something like that, to leverage on the capital that we are providing. And if it helps the project and the developer, so be it.
Nipun?
So I think it's going to be different for different investors. I think it's a product which is more suited for sovereign funds and passive capital. It's passive. We are an active manager ourselves. So we kind of have mandate issues from our LPs. It's just a mandate issue that if you have a fund raised for a continental thing, can you allocate to other funds who are doing stuff? But you need a different pool of capital than just attracting it from funds. So on transactions, I think it's more rather than coming into the vehicle, there are ways to collaborate at the transaction level. At the transaction level, one is that whatever the fund is doing, that's sufficient. But in larger deals, where there are concentration risk issues because of the size of a transaction, I think that's much kind of higher chances of collaborating in deals which are larger value. Because funds like ourselves and few others, are one of the challenges is that deal sizes should typically be on the higher side. There's no number, but you can't do 30, 40, 50 crore transactions. So if deal sizes go kind of larger and there are concentration things which you want to diversify, whether it's with Swami Fund, whether it's with our other domestic colleagues in the industry, I think those solutions will come. You will see that happen, maybe not immediately, but as this goes by, as solutions are needed for larger deals, there'll be more room to collaborate, I think, on those stuff.
Nipun, one last thing.
Go
ahead, Dharmesh bhai. Go ahead.
So both of y'all, Irfan, one key role, I think, what we look at as MCHI, this is a new emerging field for all of us. And there are obviously going to be structural issues at all levels. So one key dialogue we feel is going to be required is the understanding with the existing lender. I think we as MCHI would love to, sort of see how we can work in establishing that understanding.
Hello. What a lot of projects are not able to get NOCs from lenders. So, I guess that's one of the reasons also that even the Swami Fund is not able to do its full potential. So I think what he wants to take up as MCHI is kind of work as a bridge between the lenders and the projects which are in Swami Fund. Dharmesh, correct me if I'm wrong.
Yeah. Perfect, Manita. And second is again with the government. And third is with RERA. So I think again with RERA, there are these issues where, so if you look at the preamble of RERA, was clearly to complete projects. So I think once SMAI or any last mile funding comes in, the key would be, as I think Irfan, you also rightly mentioned, your big concern would be the outflow on account of refund and interest. So probably, a dialogue with the government that once there is a last mile funding coming in, can the payments to for refund and interest be back-ended again or till the completion of the project? So that is one other, I think, thing we need to discuss with the government. So what we would want to do is that, as sort of a takeaway from this, come up with points that we need to take up with RERA, with the institutions and with the government, and sort of circulate a note which can be a working note for projects going forward.
Sure.
Irfan, is there any specific challenges that you do want? I mean, what Kridai is saying is that we are happy to take some of this, not specifically for Swami Fund, for last mile funding. Through your experience of looking at 300, 400 deals, what are some of the common challenges that are coming up, which RERA can, which CREDAI can champion in terms of talking to RERA authorities, talking to institutions, lenders, or even IBC? I mean, one issue that Nipun talked about is IBC.
So while IBC is an issue, understand that you need to correlate it to the fact of the mandate of the fund. Like I mentioned, things like stalled projects, the fact that these projects are located anywhere in India, the fact that we are not talking of doing deals only in some certain sweet spot. We are saying we'll do deals anywhere from 5 to 400 crores. The fact that we are not going to be particularly, and this is a very strange thing for a private equity fund to say, but let me say it. We are not going to be particularly choosy of the kind of promoters that we are dealing with, because our emphasis is on home buyers. As long as there is a quantum of home buyers that need a rescue package, we can come in, right? It is for all these reasons that you need a special treatment. So when you are treating something special, you need a special treatment is my very humble submission here. We would be glad to have co-investors. An easy way to co-invest in these days is to come into our fund, right? So that's another way of going about it. There are challenges. There are significant challenges. Most of these projects are stalled, and therefore there are NCLT. Consumer redressal forum proceedings that are going on. So that's one. Just having superiority in NCLT is not a solution, because that only protects our capital. Our emphasis is not on protecting capital. Our emphasis is on completing the homes for home buyers. So if the company we are financing then goes into NCLT, and therefore the project is stuck for anywhere from 1 to 3 years, while our capital is not at risk at all, That is, you know, half our objective is being unmet. Our objective is to complete homes for home buyers, right? That's where the fund comes in, and that's where this fund has special status. So what do? We, in some cases, will insist that the project be transferred to an SPV, so that even if the parent company or the rest of the group goes through an NCLT proceedings, that proceedings would not have affected us, but will definitely affect the underlying home buyers. So we want the project to continue and to insulate itself from that NCLT risk. There will be a cost associated with it, and therefore we are willing to fund that cost as part of the project cost. There are other issues like RERA penalties. Again, we will have solutions which will be both simple and, you know, might be cumbersome to impose, but we'll require solutions. We cannot have get into a project where the project gets stuck because of RERA liabilities coming up, because of interest, because of refund coming up, and so on. And therefore, a small number of home buyers get a solution, whereas a large number of home buyers are stuck in the project. So therefore, we'll have, we are building in solutions like signing of supplemental agreements and so on. Now, these are very, very comprehensive measures. One very common referent to me is, but no one has ever done this before, right? And you're right, no one has ever done this before.
Thank you, Irfan. I think that's quite clear. You're saying, look, there are things that are around each case, especially with RERA and all of that, there are certain challenges, but I think with each case it's getting...
So the way to look at this funding is not in terms of the IRR we are targeting, right? The way to look at it is in terms of the number of home buyers that we are providing a solution to. So for example, the deals that we've currently taken through the IC process allow for completion of about 40,000 home units already. Now, that's a yardstick that we are, tracking.
Getting measured at. Yeah. So you're saying it is really looking at home buyers. It's not so much developer financing. It is more a home buyer sort of rescue.
So the emphasis is not on returns. The emphasis is only on project completion.
One of the questions I've got from the panel is, why are projects over 2 crores not being rescued? They're in the same boat. I mean, so can it increase, the limit increase to 3 or 4 or 5? More expensive. Why should the benefits only go to the suburbs?
Maybe Shobhit, you can suggest, MCHI should suggest to do Swami Fund in every state. Maybe that's the solution for COVID.
I know, it's a good and, solution actually. Why can't states
because if that is the risk of completion and you have, let's say, 40,000, 5 lakh buyers or more, you can do few state more wise. Such funds.
Nipun, in fact, that is one of the suggestions that we have strongly taken up with the government.
Yeah.
That limit has to increase to 5 crore rupees from 2 crore rupees.
Yeah, and also the size of the funding, right? Like just the sheer size.
While I can understand the motivation, there is a meaning attached to the phrase affordable and mid income. We were trying to quantify that meaning when we set out the limits. There is a significant, it's basically how much capital should go where, and therefore if the capital can be used to solve 90% plus of the problem, that's a great start.
So really the bottom of the pyramid, more sort of, you can solve more number of units at the lower base, of course, right? I understand that. That's a fair comment. And given that the government owns it, I can understand where they're coming from. You're leaving the luxury for foreign funds.
No, and we would be glad, the thinking always was, it will be great if there are more funds that can come in, especially from the private sector, with this kind of a social impact objective, right? Which is the funding is at is priced in the mid-teens or lower, and where the emphasis is on completion, not on coupon rates and so on.
Perfect.
Nipun, I actually still want to understand from you, what is it that Apollo will look at post-COVID in terms of a mindset of approaching a project? Any changes in underwriting principles?
There will be. I think it's, to be honest, you know, everybody's trying to figure that out. You know, all the earlier assumptions, you know, you can question every single thing. So it's very fluid. But clearly, I think you'll take each situation as it comes. Bombay is different from Bangalore and Bangalore from Chennai, and each market, each developer. So I think our style has never been broad brush. Our style has never been generic, where one size fits all. Our style has always been, what is that micro market? There were micro markets that we were not touching even pre-COVID, because there was just no sales happening, or there were, you know, just so many players in that micro market that that, you know, the supply far exceeded the demand. So I think at the same time, developers will also have to take a call post-COVID, which, if you have five projects going on, how do you prioritize? Can you shift your buyers to something? If you know, even the buyers will hopefully have to be explained and accommodated, like, because it is you have to question almost everything. And I think when you do that, if we are looking at any project, I think the key thing there is, ultimately, are the buyers going to come and buy it? And is the cash flows going to come? And are the returns going to get made? For that, if your assumption has to be around pricing, you'll question pricing. And I think that is an area where collectively all developers will have to give it a thought as to, is pricing going to get impacted because of COVID or no? And or is it just capital that can solve the problem? So if you just put in capital and make it, buyers will be there. Maybe not in every case. And on the second side, the government has already reduced the cost of capital to incentivize the buyer. The interest rates, do they play out? So I think we will be looking at all these signals for the projects, including pricing and how the existing buyers are behaving in the first place. Hopefully, the existing buyers are those who are still committed and continue paying. I think that is a new dimension which has got added, which wasn't the case earlier. Even if you take a period of time of a year till you don't see any new sales, or maybe, but hopefully the existing buyers will continue and the collection. So that is one metrics which one would definitely look at, that how is that behaving, and you're not seeing negative sales. And on the second side is going to be pricing, and then overall the leverage. How long can this project support that kind of leverage, whatever the cost might be?
Good, guys.
Fair point on that.
I'm quite conscious. I think
there's just one
question. One last question.
One last question. I think there was some question which has come. There's one last question coming for Nipun. Saying that since you are an AIF, you can definitely do one-time restructuring. I think I think the guidelines for AIFs are very different, and they don't come under a one-time restructuring norm. They have a mutual discussion on it. Closing remarks, Shobhit, I'll leave it to you.
Yeah, I'm happy to do it. First of all, thank you, Nipun and Irfan, taking out time on a Friday evening to talk to all of us. All our listeners are developers. I'm sure they've benefited from your very, very valuable advice. What I'm taking away is that there's enough money and liquidity for different situations, and no one size fits all. So different people will have to approach different buckets of capital. What Swami can do, perhaps Apollo can't do. What Apollo wants to do, perhaps Swami will not do. And therefore, you know, these are mutually exclusive pools of capital, and you have to respect their mandate and say, okay, this I fit into this mandate, and therefore approach that sort of funding. And there are multiple choices. Swami, of course, is very unique because it's the only sovereign fund of India, only set up for real estate. So guys, you've got away with something nice, saying, you know, government is listening to you. It's a large amount of funds that are available, 12,500 crores, deployable, can be raised up to 25,000 if it's required. I'm sure they will put in more money. But please, just to get one last message across, Irfan has said it several times that this funding is being measured on how many home buyers they rescue, not how many developers they rescue. Right? So the focus is towards low and mid-income housing and to make sure that the buyers who are stuck get their home, get the roof that they had booked many years ago. Sometimes he said 10 years. With that, thank you guys once again.
Thank you
for being on the panel. Over to you.
Vinita. I will just also, I'll just take a minute. Thank you, Mr. Kazi. I think it's been immense learning for everyone from the fact that I think as Kadai MCHI and as a real estate fraternity, we feel very happy that we have someone who's actually taken up this role to ensure that all our projects get their fair due last mile funding. I'm sure there are teething problems that we all come into in this entire journey, but I'm sure jointly, like Dharmesh Bhai has put across, we should come together and make representations so that, you know, everything, including the NOC part, the RERA part, the regulation part, we can work jointly and make those amendments so that people get their last mile fundings going forward. Thank you, Mr. Nipun Sahni. I think very valid points also from the fact that, you know, even as funds, y'all are looking at some amount of IBC protection for last mile funding, which is a very, very important part for anyone who's looking at coming into this business in India. And absolutely appreciate, Shobhit, your entire mannerism in which you've done this session. It's immense learning with every time that we have you. And like I said, you are a friend, philosopher, guide to almost everyone in real estate. So thank you so much for being there all the time. Thank you everyone for watching in. We hope we could cover all your questions and answers. Sorry if we've missed out some of the points, but yeah, we tried to get most of the content in this short while. We look forward to seeing you again in the next webinar. Thank you so much, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you. Stay thank safe. You. Stay strong.
Thank
bye.
You. Get upon. Thank you.
Thanks, everyone. Thanks. Stay safe.
And all the
thank you.
Thanks.
Stay safe.
Thanks.
Take care. Bye.
Thanks.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.